Could everybody please find your seats? We're ready to get started. And as you find your seat, you might just want to stand up because we're going to be reading God's Word. This morning I'm blessed to have my very lovely wife, Mary, do the reading for me.
Okay, I'll be reading out of 1 Kings chapter 18, verses 20 through 40. So Ahab sent for all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together on Mount Carmel. And Elijah came to all the people and said, "How long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him." But the people answered him not a word. Then Elijah said to the people, "I alone am left the prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. Therefore, let them give us two bulls, and let them choose one bull for themselves, cut it into pieces, and lay it on the wood. But put no fire under it, and I will prepare the other bull and lay it on the wood and put no fire under it. Then you call on the name of your gods, and I will call on the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire, he is God." So all the people answered and said, "It is well spoken." Now Elijah said to the prophet of Baal, "Choose one bull for yourselves and prepare it first, for you are many, and call on the name of your God, but put no fire under it." So they took the bull, which was given them, and they prepared it, and called on the name of Baal from morning, evening, till noon, saying, "O Baal, hear us." But there was no voice and no answer. Then they leaped about the altar which they had made. And so it was at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, "Cry aloud, for he is a god. Either he is meditating, or he is busy, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is sleeping and must be awakened." So they cried aloud and cut themselves, as was their custom, with knives and lances, until the blood gushed out on them. And when midday passed, they prophesied until the time of the offerings of the evening sacrifice, but there was no voice, no one answered, no one paid attention. Then Elijah said to all the people, "Come near to me." So all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of tribes of the son of Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, "Israel shall be your name." Then when the stones, he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench around the altar large enough to hold two seals of seed. And he put the wood in order, cut the bull in pieces, and laid it on the wood and said, "Fill four water pots with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood." Then he said, "Do it a second time." And they did it a second time. And he said, "Do it a third time." And they did it a third time. So the water ran all around the altar, and he also filled the trench with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, "Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that you are the Lord God, and that you have turned their hearts back to you again." Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust, and it licked up the water that was in the trench. Now when all the people saw that, they fell on their faces, and they said, Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. And Elijah said to them, seize the prophets of Baal. Do not let one of them escape. So they seized them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and executed them there. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just pray that you would bless this service this morning. We just invite the Holy Spirit to come into this place and fill each and every one of us, that we will hear your word and your word would come true, that you would open our hearts and our minds, that you would change our lives, Lord, today. And as we leave this building, we will have heard the word of God and our lives will have been changed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, thank you, Mary. All right, my name's Patrick Houg, associate pastor here. A lot of people ask me what I do. I'm not sure, they're not sure, so we're just leaving it there. I have a few hats in my office, I think, but that's all good. So here we are. 1 Kings chapter 18, 20 through 24. A story probably most of you have heard at some point in your life. And sometimes, I'll be honest with you, sometimes these stories, we kind of shut down when we are all... It's Elijah and the prophets of Baal, you know, and we start shutting down and we stop listening. After the first service, there was a young couple that reminded me of this very thing. They came up and they said, you know what, when we first came, we saw what you were going to be teaching on. We saw this portion of scripture and we just figured, well, there's nothing here for us. But God. God spoke into their lives something. They came up and they cried before the Lord. See, God's word is alive and powerful. I don't care how many times you've heard it. Shame on us if we hear the simple message of the gospel and we just say, well, that's no big deal. I know that. You know, we need to be men and women that are attentive to hear what God has to say to us. We need to be open-eared every time we walk in here, not become so religious as we step in this door. It's a Sunday, we're going to church, or after church we're doing this and this and this, and just become this robot. Well, in fact, Elijah is coming against that very thing. We're going to talk about Baal and the prophets of Baal. We're going to talk about the children of Israel, how they had a choice between two opinions. That tells me, when I hear them saying there's two opinions, that means they were struggling with light and darkness. They were struggling with the true God and the pagan god, Baal. See, we should always come looking to see what God has for each one of us. I can guarantee you this, when we come and seek him and ask him, he's going to show himself strong. Just as we're going to read in this passage this morning, he's going to show himself strong. God loves people of prayer. Prep yourself before you come to church, before you get into your car. Prep yourself saying, Lord, open my mind, open my ears, open my heart to receive what you have for me this morning. You know, and when we come with that attitude, that's an expectation that God's going to exceed. It's going to be more than what you could even ask or think, because God is mighty. So we start out the OK Corral. Here we go. Good against evil. We had the Clayton group going against the Earps. The big fight. Everybody seen that OK Corral? Big Western fan, huh? Yeah, most of you, some of you. Well, here, let me just make it real simple. It was a 15-minute gunfight. And that was it. Guys got killed. Some guys lived. But there was definitely a fight that happened. There was a fight against the good, the marshals, trying to uphold the law, and the other group that wanted to go against the law or was carrying a vendetta because of somebody that was killed in the family. See, this is named OK Corral because this is a showdown. This very mountaintop on Mount Carmel is going to be a showdown between God and Baal. It's going to be a very, very fair contest. It's going to be constructed in such a way that by the end of this reading today, there will be no doubt who was the winner, who is the true God. And Elijah, a man who's been hanging out with a widow and raising her son from the dead, and he was a man who was led by the Spirit of God. Don't you love that? Don't you want that in your life? I so desperately desire that in my life. I want to be led by the Spirit of God. Elijah, God would speak to him and say, Elijah, I want you to go over here. Well, now, Elijah, I want you to go back to Ahab. I want you to go before him. You know, I want to be a man who clearly hears God's word. Okay, I'm going. I don't care how far away it is. I don't care if that man wanted to take my life. Because remember, the last time they met, it was going to be about 3.5 years before there's rain in your kingdom again, Ahab. 3.5 years. So you can imagine, Ahab was out to find this man. Ahab wanted Elijah dead, basically. You know, anybody who brings truth sometimes isn't welcomed very well, especially when it brings hardship to a nation or hardship to a household. But we have Obadiah. Obadiah's out with Ahab looking for some fresh water. It's been over 3 years now. God's going to bring some rain. But they're out looking for some water because he had, if you were here last week, Pastor Paul spoke about how Ahab's thought on animals was greater and he cared more than the people. And so he's looking for this water, and so Obadiah's out looking too, and he runs into Elijah. Elijah says, hey, I want to meet Ahab, bring him to me. And Obadiah's not too crazy about that idea, because Obadiah was worried that Elijah, being a man who would be led by the Spirit of God, God might lead him somewhere else. And if that happened, Ahab would kill Obadiah. Because he lied to him, basically, because Elijah's not there. He wanted him so badly. Obadiah even said, hey, Elijah, remember, I knew the Lord from my childhood. As a little child, I feared the Lord. Oh, and by the way, I hid 100 prophets. I hid 100 prophets for the Lord. 2 separate caves, but I hid them and took care of them. And so he's just like, come on, don't ask this of me, Elijah. And Elijah, he says, you know what, here, I'm going to encourage, Elijah encourages him, tells him, I will be here. Go get Ahab. Go get Ahab. So Obadiah, you know, fearing the Lord, fearing Elijah, fearing Ahab, went and got Ahab and said, Elijah wants to speak with you. So that's where we pick this up. We pick this up, and Ahab comes before Elijah. And first thing Ahab says to Elijah is, oh, Elijah, you're the troubler of Israel. Elijah just kind of looks back at him and says, no, Ahab, you are, because you don't follow the commandments of God. So the setup is this. We have Jezebel. We have Ahab. They have already went through the mountaintops, went through the different areas of sacrifice and have torn down altars. We have Elijah just following what the Lord tells him to do. Even in this great battle on this mountain, he's following every step the Lord's told him to do. And we have Obadiah just kind of, you know, hoping I stay alive. And so in verse 19 of chapter 18, we start there. And it says, now therefore send and gather all Israel to me on Mount Carmel, the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table. So get all these guys together. because we're going to have a rumble. We're going to prove who is God. And so he tells them to get together all 950 of the prophets. Of course, we're going to, as we go through this scripture, we're only going to really see 450 talked about. So where were the other 400? I don't know. It doesn't say. But we know that Elijah wanted to get them up on this mountain. We need to get them together. And so they go, and the most interesting thing about this whole thing is it's been almost 3.5 years. And what does God do? God's going to turn the heart of the people before he brings that rain. Ain't that something in our life? God wants to do something in our life. And because of the Baals that may be in our closets or in our life, we don't see the rain because we're so stuck on our gods, those who we have made ourselves, those of the world, those things that just pull us down and contorts the understanding of who the true God is. And so we've got all the setup is everything's in place. We got the prophets up there. And so in verse 20 it says, so Ahab sent all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together on Mount Carmel. All right, Mount Carmel is about 1,700 feet above sea level. As you can see there on the left side of the map, right there and right there, you see Mount Carmel. Also, Haifa is just a little ways away. You can see the Sea of Galilee in the middle there. And so the location of Mount Carmel is that, the Mediterranean to the back of it, and the valley of Jezreel is to the east of it. Here's an aerial shot of the monastery that's found on Mount Carmel. I seem to have lost most of my pictures from the when I went on to Israel, so I was going to show you some pictures of some cool people I went with, but it's in my house somewhere. So I pulled this one off the internet. But this gives you a good understanding of the valley that's down below, and the Mediterranean is to the left side of it there. It's a monastery that sits up there, and in that monastery we have a statue of Elijah commemorating the killing of the 450 prophets of Baal. This is also in that courtyard up there. It's an amazing place. I'm jealous for those people who are over there now, our pastor and the other pastors and men and women that went. It's a great place to go, and just this, it brings all of this so much more to light when you read this scripture. So they've got them all up there. They're up there in verse 21, and Elijah came to all the people and said, how long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him. But the people answered him not. ESV, for that word faltering, says go limping. NIV is waver. The Message is sit on the fence. It really gives you a good understanding of what is being said here. How long will you vacillate between or falter between two opinions? You know, how long is that going to happen? They knew who God was or is, and they also knew who Baal was or was not ever. But they have these ideas. And so they're probably struggling. And I think of the struggling and I think of myself. I think of I can't be alone. The struggles in life, those things that call to my attention, you know, that I exalt above God, before God. You know, those Baals, this world kind of entangles our feet in at times. You know, we need to stop faltering. We need to stop sitting on the fence. As Christians, we need to know who God is. And I tell you what, after the worship set we just went through, I don't know how you cannot know who God is. Because every one of those songs, when you worship to God, how can you not know He is God Almighty? that he is the one true God. And yet the people at this point are faltering. They're going back and forth. They're not sure of what's going on. And what is their answer? No answer. Have I ever been in that place when somebody asked me, what is that hope found in you? And I just stop and don't say anything. You know, we can't be people like that. We can't be those faltering. We need to have that answer for the hope that's found within us. We need to be able to speak truth into people's lives, no matter how much they may desire to kill you or take you out or take your position at work or whatever it is. We can't be those people. And here they didn't have an answer. Baal and Asherah, they were gods and goddesses of husbandry, of storms and fertility. They were those kind of pagan gods. As men, as women, we fashion these gods into something that we want them to look like. And that's what the prophets of Baal, that's what they had done. They had taken this guy and turned him into, you know, he's the one that'll bring rain to the country. And so you can see how this battle is shaping up, because we're coming against God who created all things and sustains all things and stopped the rain. And now they're going to go battling, because it's been a long time since the rain has been there. So over three years, the people said nothing. You know what? Did they forget who God was? Did they forget he was the God that took them out of Egypt, that took them out of bondage? Pastor Steve talked about that this morning, about bondage. God is the breaker of bondage. He is the one that can cut any shackle that the world has fashioned on you, or you've taken it upon yourself to fashion. He's able to break those chains. And have they forgotten about the great exploits of Joshua as he led the children of Israel into the promised land and the great victories that came when everybody thought there ain't no way these places are going to be taken down? But see, they had forgotten because they have allowed Baal, they have allowed the world to commingle with the truth that they knew. And I am here to say, when you do that, your truth is going to be very diluted. And even to a point where it's going to be hard to even see the truth anymore. Then Elijah said to the people, I alone am left a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450. So this battle is going to be one against 450. Slam dunk. You prophets should have no problem with this. The problem is they were serving a pagan god that was deaf and dumb, that had no power. And Elijah was serving a god that had all power, that still continues to have all power. Elijah, even if there was, isn't it amazing how God does these battles? He sends in the few so that he can receive the glory. And Elijah says, okay, you guys have 450, so here's what's going to happen. Here's the ground rules. Therefore, let them give us two bowls, and let them choose one bowl for themselves, cut it into pieces, and lay it on the wood. But put no fire under it. And I will prepare the other bowl and lay it on the wood, but put no fire under it. Then you call on the name of your gods, and I will call on the name of the Lord, and the God who answers by fire, he is God. So all the people answered and said, hey, it is well spoken. So they're like, okay, the rules of engagement sound good here. You know, it seems to take man out of the equation. All man has to do is set up that altar, and then the fire doesn't come from man, but it comes from Baal or it comes from God. And you know what? The prophets of Baal are probably thinking, you know what, this is a slam dunk for us because our God throws lightning. Lightning will start fire. But the battle's on. Now Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose one bowl for yourselves and prepare it first, for you are many and call in the name of your God, but put no fire under it. So he says, here you go. Go ahead and pick whichever one you want, because there might be one of the bowls that has water retention that day. You know, maybe a little too wet, but you pick whichever one you want. And so we see that Elijah is setting this up so that there is no possibility that was anybody but God that's going to bring victory, that's going to bring the fire. So they took the bowl which was given them, they prepared it and called on the name of Baal from morning till noon, saying, oh, Baal, hear us. But there was no voice, no one answered. Then they leaped about the altar, which what they made. So the picture, can you imagine the picture? They're up on this hill. 450 prophets of Baal, 450 guys jumping around, crying out, oh, Baal. They cut it up, and they started from morning till noon. So I'm going to be very conservative. I'm going to give them 3 hours of jumping around. For 3 hours, they jumped around, calling out to their God. After 3 hours, I'm thinking, guys, are you real? 450, the noise that it must have caused, leaping, jumping. Aren't you glad that we serve a God, that we can be on our knees and he hears us? That we don't have to jump around? That we don't have to yell? But we can go into our closet, we could fall on the floor right here and pray to him, and he is a God that will lower his ear to hear what you have to say, that will instantly be there. You know, these other pagan idols, they had to always yell for him, always call out for him, always do something. All we need to do is pray. And so it was at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, cry aloud, for he is God. Either he is meditating, he is busy, he's on a journey, or perhaps he's sleeping and must be awakened. You know, if you're a God, you've got to be pretty busy, right? And you need your rest, you need your meditation, you need all this stuff. Well, here we have Elijah, and I don't know if this is right or wrong, but he mocked him. All I know this, Elijah did what God told him to do. And you know what? Maybe he was just trying to help him out, help him to understand, help the people around that were watching this whole thing go on. Maybe he was getting everybody to think, wow, where is this God? Where is this God? Meditating? Or he's busy? You know, that basically breaks down to maybe he's in the little God's bathroom. You know, that's basically that what that interprets, that he was relieving himself. He was on a journey. You know, there is something about our God, a God who is everywhere at all times, that is able to hear us no matter what depths we may be in. If we cry out to him, he hears us. And so it was noon. Psalm 121, verses 3 and 4 says this, He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. This is one of the Psalms of the Ascents, when they would go to Jerusalem 3 times a year. All males were required to go 3 times a year. And they would say this. They would repeat this. They would sing this, knowing, reminding themselves, not only speaking to God, but reminding themselves, you know what? Maybe we're kind of messed up. My Bible plan, I'm only going to hit this verse 1 time in a year. Maybe I need to look at it at least 3 times a year. Maybe I need to look at it more often to remind myself that what this world has to offer, or what sin I'm playing with, has no place in my life.
because I have a God who is awake, who doesn't sleep. So they cried aloud and cut themselves, as was their custom, with knives and lances until the blood gushed out on them. So now they've worked up into the second layer of frenzy. 450 people jumping around, cutting themselves, blood probably flying everywhere. Some probably dropping because of the loss of blood, thinking that our blood's going to get our God's attention. Well, praise God, we only have Jesus Christ's blood to worry about. And in that covering, we are safe. See, we don't have to do any of that stuff. We don't need to do that to make ourselves more righteous, more pure. This was a pagan ritual. In fact, in Leviticus 19:28, you who shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor tattoo any marks on you. I am the Lord. The Lord says you don't need to cut yourself. Why cut yourself? You will get God's attention quicker if you pray. If you ask God, because I know cutting can be an issue in our society. But we need to seek God. We need to cry out to Him. But they're jumping around. They're doing all crazy stuff. And when midday was past, they prophesied until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice. But there was no voice. No one answered. No one paid attention. So now I'm going to be concerted, and I'm going to say 6 hours. They've been doing this little ritual for 6 hours because the evening sacrifice is coming, and usually you want to start that by around 3 o'clock because by 6 o'clock the new day starts. So you just want to make sure. So let's take 6 hours. I cannot understand why they went on for 6 hours. How darkened was their understanding? How much did they not understand that God was God and this was just an idol made with man's hands? So they cried out louder. They jumped around. Blood's all over the place. And Elijah said to all the people, "Come near to me." So all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, "Israel shall be your name." Then with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench around the altar large enough to hold 2 sizes of seed. It really doesn't matter the last part. I mean, it was a trench. Whether it was something that would contain 5.5 gallons or would it be something to contain more, no one really knows for sure. But the thing we have to know that there was a trench dug around, almost to the effect that this trench separated the offering from the world. It separated it. This portion was wholly unto God. It's like that divining line. You know, so many times I in my life I think, man, I got to draw a line there because it seems like I keep pushing too far. I got to draw a line that says, you know what, on this side is set apart and holy for God. On that side, it's the world. I don't care. I don't need it. So he rebuilds this altar, probably one Jezebel, Ahab may have destroyed. This whole time, this whole event's happening, the prophets of Baal are dancing around here, and I've got to believe those children of Israel were standing there and seeing this thing that was over here, kind of like a pile of rocks. Maybe not even understanding what that was about. But see, Elijah knew. And Elijah, being instructed by God, told him to go over there and rebuild that, because that is my altar. And so, of course, he took the 12 stone, Jacob, his sons, 12 sons, the 12 tribes come through there, and, And of course, Jacob's name being changed from Jacob to Israel after his encounter with God. And so he starts rebuilding this, and he makes the little trench around, and he put the wood in order. He cut the bull in pieces. He laid it on the wood and said, fill 4 water pots with water. Pour it on the burnt soft sacrifice and on the wood. Then he said, do it a second time. They did it a second time. He said, do it a third time. And they did it a third time, ran around. So the water ran all around the altar and also filled the trench with water. How much water? It doesn't really matter. All I know is this. The first time I pour water on something, some of it's going to soak in, some of it's going to run off. I pour water a second time, guess what? There's going to be more that soaks in, but I'll still have some runoff. Third, pretty much everything's going to be pretty saturated with that third one, and still some water may run off. So the whole part here is Elijah's just making sure that no man can take God's glory. That no man has a man match big enough to start that fire because it is totally soaked. It is totally soaked. So this whole setup is to show the power and the might of God. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel and I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that you are the Lord God and that you have turned their hearts back to you again. Elijah didn't start jumping around dancing. He didn't start cutting himself. What did Elijah do? He prepared the altar, got it all set up, and he went and prayed. You know what? In our lives, church, in our lives, we need to be those men and women that do what God tells us to do by the Spirit of God, and then allow God's power to do the rest. And that's what we're seeing here. We're seeing how Elijah was just being a prophet doing what he was told. And now it was God's turn. And he also said, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. You know what, I bet you that probably, if they were in earshot, the children of Israel probably thought, wow, yeah, I remember Grandpa saying stuff like that. His prayers, he would say things like that. Hopefully it would resonate. But it was the Lord God who was going to turn back their hearts to you again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt off sacrifices and the wood and the stones and the dust. It licked up the water that was in the trench. So what did it consume? Everything. Everything. So many times we've made jump through that verse and not seen even the dust. Even the dust was consumed by the fire of God. Even that trench full of water was dried out by the power of God. The stones, everything. You tell me, who is God? No man could have done that. No fire hot enough at that time could have done that. And yet God brought down the fire. God licked everything up. Now when all the people saw it, they fell on their face and they said, the Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God. Little exclamation point on there. When we run into these struggles in our life, when we run into the issues of sin in our life, when we run into the world calling us and pulling us away, what do we say? Do we say, well, I don't know? Or do we say, the Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God. These people needed to understand for their hearts to be turned. They needed to understand. And Matthew chapter 6, verse 24 says, no one can serve two masters, for either he'll hate the one and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. We can't serve the world and Christ. We can't. It's nonsense. It's like dancing around an offering trying to get a hold of a pagan god. We've got to stop faltering. We've got to stop sitting on the fence. And that's every part of our life. I'm not just talking, you know, maybe somebody sees a big sin. I'm talking every part of my life. Every day, as I even walked in this morning, was the Lord dealing with me on something? I can tell you the Lord's dealing with me on stuff. God's Word. God's Word. Don't ever get to a place where you think you don't need to hear God's Word. That will happen if you allow the world to infiltrate your Christian walk. And it's easy to do. It's so easy to do. But yet there is even these major battles that happen because we've allowed certain things to take root in our life. Well, I say today we need to allow God's fire to cleanse you. We need God's fire to cleanse myself. We need to allow God room to take care of what he needs to take care of in our life. So Elijah said to them, "Seize the prophets of Baal. Do not let one of them escape." So they seized them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and executed them there. A little 1,000-foot drop down to the brook, and they took out the 450 prophets of Baal. Why? Because they were false prophets. And in Deuteronomy chapter 13, talks about what happens with false prophets. They are killed. They are killed. So we have all these battles going on in our life at different moments, different sizes. But we have to know who God is. We have to know that he is the one and true God, that he is more than able to take care of any little situation in your life, little sin in your life. He's also able to take care of those big sins, those big situations in your life. Joshua said this in 24:15, "If it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." See, we need to make a choice. We need to make a choice today. We need to make a choice tomorrow morning. We need to make a choice the next day. When I read scripture like this, my spirit says, "Yahoo!" My flesh says, "Ugh, I don't want to hear any of that. I don't want to change. I'm good right where I'm at." Well, today's the day you need to make that choice. Either God is God, or the things in your life are. So, Father, we just thank you, Lord. We thank you for your word. Father, it is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. And, Lord, I thank you for these examples that you bring out in your scripture, Lord. I know there's a reason for it, because we all have to learn lessons. We all need to learn to look to you for everything, not to hold on to anything this world has for us, but Lord, to hold on to everything you have for us. So Father, I just pray for every person here who may have came in this morning struggling with what's going on in their life, struggling with sin, addiction, whatever it may be. Father, I pray today that they build an altar for you and allow you to show your strength in their life. Father, I thank you that you love each one of us so much, that you would just hear our little muffled cries, that we don't have to do anything but just ask. And maybe you're here this morning and you're kind of like, "Well, I'm not sure what he's talking about, what kind of a battle." Maybe you don't need Jesus Christ, you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Well, then I pray today would be that day. Very simple, you just got to come to the end of yourself. Know that you're a sinner, that you repent of that sin, that you believe on Jesus Christ who was raised from the dead, that his blood is sufficient to cover anything in your life. Maybe you're here this morning and that is speaking into your heart. And I pray as we end here, as Ashley closes us in worship, come up to the front, speak with one of our pastors, elders, prayer warriors, so that we can point you in the right direction. And so, Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you, Lord, that you've begun a work in a lot of us. And I thank you that you're not too sleepy, but you're wide awake at all times of my days. Lord, we just give you praise and glory for what you're doing, what you will do, and what you have done. In Jesus' name.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.